So I would like to come back to maybe a few words of presentation of myself. My name is Nicolas Boiteau. I'm actually living in Bucharest, not in Barcelona. Barcelona, as it is being said in the brochure for the conference. I'm working for Société Générale. I'm a data scientist for close to 20 years. I did a PhD in quantitative finance that now we probably put into machine learning, applied to finance. I've been a quantitative trader for 10 years, and then progressively I shifted to the IT and started to do data science for the rest of the bank, meaning the rest, not only financial markets, but helping all the teams in IT, in back office operations, central functions, and all of them. And currently, I'm located in Bucharest because we have several what we call service centers, and I'm a lead data scientist, leading a center of excellence on data science for Romania, Bucharest, but also for India, where we have two very important service centers. So in total, we have, I think, something like 12,000 people working within these three locations. And new challenges, very interesting challenges that I'm following for the last 5 or 6 years now. I'm gonna come back to one interesting topic. When Philippe Bell, the organizer, asked me about if I wanted to join the conference, I'm very pleased to do that. And he asked me about what I could talk about, and I saw data and the machine as the title of the conference, and I found it very, inspiring. It's clear that our data perimeter is no longer the work of isolated team craftsman that would do their own on their side with data that they would collect from here and there. Kind of, it has become a business, a huge business. All the companies listed that are contributing, the main lead contributors into data and AI overall, in the essentially the American landscape. We could have more names if we include also Europe and India, for instance. And it's clear that it has become a huge business. It has become a huge business, and therefore this idea of the data scientist, which is probably let's say the emblematic new position during this data transformation, data revolution, is probably it has become a generic word, a generic job title. But now we have a collection of positions that exist within our companies, especially the very large ones, which is my case. And I took the pretext of talking about data and the machine and talking about, okay, what about this data scientist that exists since the beginning of the 2010s? It's not older than that, I guess. When I started my career, we didn't talk about data scientists. We talk about quant analysts, quant trader. I was quant trader or systematic trader. So in the bank, in finance, we didn't talk about data scientists. And it's clear that this term has become a kind of a generic of, or it came with data and AI revolution that we have been experiencing over the last decade. And I wanted to take this pretext to talk about the evolution of our perimeter. And it's clear that, and I think we will all agree that all our companies are now what we would like to say as being data-driven organization, meaning that whatever we do, we are a tech company. We are tech companies overall. I think it's very clear for banks. We are tech companies involved into financial and banking services. So, but as a pillar, we have IT. Obviously, we have a lot of all our services are becoming more and more automated, and it has become a reality with since the COVID last year, if it was not the case before. But we have been accelerating. So IT is a pillar of a bank and of any probably any company, but also data. So data sits somewhere between the business side and the IT side, and we take contribution for all this perimeter, and it has become a kind of a pillar in each company. So companies usually they start to refer as themselves as being data driven, meaning that data is like the IT. It's a new essential pillar within any organization, and therefore this is where So data is an industry. Data is a pillar in our companies. And what's the role of our data scientists? And when we think a bit, let's say, back in time, and I'm thinking maybe before the internet era, before the big data era that started around 2005, between 2005 and 2010 for the most advanced of us, and now it has spread worldwide and in any organization now. So what we could think about is that if you had a data warehouse like 10 to 15 years ago, you were already fairly advanced. It was maybe just like a Microsoft used for all your analytics, but it was already a nice thing. So between your operational databases that sits on the left part, your CRM, whatever type of database that we could think about that are used in production, you could already copy and process these data, store them in, then create all the BI tools that are necessary for all the perimeter of your activities, of your company. So that was something that was nice, but still a small scale. This is where I think we were still at a moment where it was the work of a craftsman, something that is kind of bespoke or done by a couple of people, and that's okay. That's okay. But now the architecture has become far more complex. So we still are connected to the same time of databases, but we have let's say data in structured format, data in non-structured format like videos, any type of images, text that we can process, log of our IT applications. We have data that we ingest by batch. We have data that we need to process on real time. We have several type of databases to handle to make the most of the fastest for all the type of queries that we need to process and so on. So it has become very much more, far more complex than what it used to be. And therefore, the emergence of a dedicated population, data engineers essentially, that are, taking care of all this architecture, which is it has become a job on its own to do all that. And I'm not saying anything. Just that actually, in order to generate the same type of BI, the same type of, it has become far more complex. We want to go further. We have more data. So the volume, the variety of data, the need to process them on a real time, to do interactive queries and so on, it has implied that we need specialists. So what about our data scientists? And the data scientists that we thought about was the 2010. If you look carefully on the Wikipedia page of the data scientist, you see that it's very recent. We find one or two people before 2010 or 2012, actually, who actually had the job title officially of being a data scientist. But I was doing data science, clearly finding algorithm and trading systematically, automatically on financial markets before this time. And the thing that was very interesting is that no one was talking about data science. The word didn't exist. So it could be this type of person, a Thai, the usually a man. I hope it's now far more balanced. But it's clear that we had this type of persons who were incapacity to do a bit of everything. And this is my main message. The data scientist used to be a craftsman, and with this ability of processing data, of being very flexible in the way they were doing all the statistical analysis, the modeling, and even the deployment in production was not really something that we care at that time. Not on the trading side, where it was already very well formatted, and we had deployment guidance and guidelines that were fairly strict. But it's clear that at that time, the data scientist was more like someone coming from a data lab or sitting in a data lab that was not really involved into day-to-day production activities. They were here to build up some proof of concept and making sure that this enhanced the visibility of a company, but not really into day-to-day activities of production activities. So clearly, I think we can date back to 2012, and you will see why I'm using this date as a starting point. So our data scientist was someone with a background in applied mathematics or any quantitative science field, maybe finance, maybe statistics, maybe what? applied mathematics, and they were expert in machine learning algos. And I think that was the new thing, because our data analyst, I think my neighbor is starting to hammering the wall. I hope it won't last. Otherwise, I will need to go to another room. So we had a lot of people expert on data working with us for some time. After all, we had this simple data pipeline with the data warehouse that I was describing before. So we had data analysts generating all the reports that we need. That was fairly nice. And usually these people were either these data analysts, they exist for some time, I would say 30 years at least. So these people were using like a type of SaaS as a software solution or Excel. And they were in production, and they had to deliver periodically reports, weekly, monthly, quarterly, find your favorite frequency. Okay, so the data scientist was coming with a new, let's say, new profile, maybe far more, familiar, not if not expert on some other machine learning algos that we are not used for all the reports so far, and a person that was already in capacity to do some programming. And it's clear that when we starting to have open source libraries like TensorFlow, released in open source by Google in 2015, and stable a bit later, but let's say the very first version were in 2015. The overall community and let's say all the industries realized that they could make the most of what Google and this type of very advanced companies in terms of AI could do on their own internally. And that was kind of a revolution. That's where we started to need a data scientist, maybe not for once again for production, but at least to build what could be the future of these companies in terms of automation, in terms of advanced analytics, predictive, call it as you want, but let's say advanced analytics that usually combine standard analytics with time series, with clustering, with classification, maybe even, why not, deep learning techniques, and make the most of it. So that's where you start having a company that is progressively being AI or data driven. And these people are key for the for this part, but it was the early stage, and now the as we have become an industry overall, the data and as the data perimeter in a company is very large with people getting specialized, I think the data scientist is someone that will progressively disappear from our radar. We have now people who become specialists. And there is one thing that is interesting to notice, is that we have the emergence, I think it's Gartner in 2019 who started to talk about that, at least at scale, talking about citizen data scientists, which I like to talk about data citizen. And I think this is a promising new category of data professionals within our organization. When I say data professionals, by the way, I may be a bit far-fetched. They may be business people or business technologists, people who have the ability to, let's say, do some, for sure, some analysis. Suspect in terms of solutions, BI, SaaS, Dataiku, Alteryx, and so on. I think I listed a couple of them: Data Robot, Dataiku, Tableau, and probably some others that I'm missing. But you get the idea that there are plenty of solutions which somehow bridge the gap between this data scientist that is working with some open source solutions that are already not too difficult to use, but you need a bit of coding, you need to be really hands-on into these techniques in Python to make the most of it. And in particular, the initial part we call data wrangling, all the data preparation, that is, if you don't know how to proceed with that, it's going to be a showstopper. You can always click on your model and try to fit it, but if you don't know how to prepare your data set beforehand, it's a showstopper. So clearly we have, because it's an ongoing process, we have a couple of people who are emerging as data citizens. And these data citizens, they may clearly exceed the population of data scientists and the impact of data scientists within our organization. So this is, once again, this is Gartner. The numbers were reported by Alteryx in one of their presentations recently that I attended. And I find it very interesting, meaning that when you look at all the business users, those of us, I'm not us, because I'm not a business user, but those of our colleagues in our organization who are, let's say, consuming the reports, consuming the automation tools that we are developing, they will stay overly fairly stable. The thing that is important also is that if you look at the data scientists, they were in short numbers, small numbers in 2015. Okay, they will double in size. That's the expectation from Gartner by 2025. But it's not like a massive extension of our data scientists. While we need a lot of data professionals. So where will it come from? Actually, it will come from all the people who are, let's say, expert in Excel, SQL queries. So they could be SQL developers, ETL developers sometime. They could be good at VBA for some of their automation on Excel. And they will progressively be trained using Python, which is not too difficult for them. And they will become also incapacitive if they have like tools which are kind of low code, be incapacity to become data citizen and do a lot of data scientist projects. So I think that's really the moment when we're, at least in our company where we stand, when I'm actually animating this data citizen program for the group, for Société Générale, when we try to have a lot of people who are now incapacity to do projects. I don't want to say on their own. We have a mentoring program behind the scene, so we help them. But they are on data with where they are permissioned. They know about the business domain. They know about the kind of how can I say that, the kind of problem we want to solve. Optimize. So they have all this background, and they have followed some internal certification, and then they can really do some of the work with a bit of assistance from a senior data scientist. So actually, maybe our data scientists will become kind of supervising different projects and bringing the technical know-how about the algo, about how to use them, the know-how about how to handle project management projects in data, which is not that standard. The category I won't touch upon for now, but it's clear that we need a data project manager or AI product owner. I like to call it this way. So it's a new category, which if the expectation is fulfilled, 50 million worldwide of data citizen or citizen data scientists by 2025, clearly it will become the very large pool of data specialists. So I won't have time to cover the whole story. Which I like, but it's clear that the data scientist is somehow related to the breakthrough of deep learning or deep neural networks and the fact that they became progressively open source and so on. Fantastic revolution. But I will maybe share the slides if you want to have a look at that more carefully. So let's do a short quiz. So I have listed a couple of skills. So Python. Skills on knowledge on data structure and machine learning algo, ethics of AI, responsible AI, a very important and growing topic these days. Extended knowledge on SQL queries, even non-SQL queries. They know how to
do versioning
of the code. They can build up microservices using Flask and REST API. Maybe they can also deploy in production using a virtual machine or Dockers and orchestrators like Kubernetes. So they have all this IT knowledge. Maybe at some point they can use distributed computing if the training of the models is fairly lengthy or long to do, and use Spark, one of the leading technology in the field. And then they can maybe also use that in production. So when you deploy in production, you may want to also use the right version of your model and do. So who I am, if I have all these skills, which you use, by the way. You cannot be junior and master all that. It's a lot of work. So who could I be? I could be the machine learning engineer. I like this terminology, and I think that's the one that is being used now within the GAFAM and the very the most advanced AI-driven companies or tech companies. And I think it can be a replacement of what we think now as being the data scientist. So the data scientist was, for me, I think it's a dated word. I still use it sometimes because I don't want to explain that actually our business has become an industry. But it's clear that for me, it was the it's like the grandfather of all the, this new position, and I would like to summarize them. So, if our data scientist, which I will qualify as a full stack data specialist or data professional, so someone that has knowledge about the data, the type of database that they can query, they have some knowledge, 25% on the business side, they have some, so that they know what they are investigating, the business domain that they are investigating. It's very important to know that. We cannot stay blind and just look at the data and do a project and then go to another one. This simply doesn't work. It's knowledge about the algo. This is the 25% model that we have on the bottom left of this this kind of SWOT. And 25% DevOps, meaning ability as an IT professional to do monitoring of this model in production. Because now we don't do just that in our data labs. We deploy that on a production platform, and we need to be able to do all that. So do we have someone with all this knowledge? I don't know if we can interact. I see that it's a bit complex. So let me give you an answer. My point is that, and I'm almost done. 1 minute to go. So it would be the kind of unicorn in the data perimeter. If some data scientists now that exist for, I don't know, the last 10 years would be clearly expert in all these domains. They must be super senior. We see with with our people getting specialized in each of the domain, is that we see some new profile emerging. So I think we have the ML ops, people who are really dedicated to maintaining these models, machine learning models in production, which is a job on its own. Maybe I can cope with that, for instance, and I am trying to catch up with that for some time to with our people locally, internally. But it's clear that we need specialists. It's the same for the data. We need data engineers, people who have the ability to do all the ETL work, whether it's with dedicated proprietary solution like Informatica, Talent, and so on, but also people expert on Spark that I mentioned already. So clearly, this is a specific category of people. And usually they are really accustomed or really expert on all the Hadoop ecosystem, how to maintain a big data stack, which is clearly a set of skills that you need to concentrate to be. So we have the ML engineer that I already mentioned, someone who is expert on the algos. It's clear that we have we can use a low code solution like the Alteryx, Dataiku, DataRobot, and so on that I already mentioned. You can click and train your model. They will train like a basket of a bunch of models. But which one would you use? Just because it has a better accuracy? Really? Will you do that? No, you need people who are specialists on the algo. It is a field where we have like a very large variety of algo, and you need people who are specialists. So these ML engineers are being required, especially if you do deep learning. And then we have this data scientism that I like to talk about. I think it's a promising category. People who are still sitting on the business, they could still also sit on the IT side, but they are staying with their original perimeters, whether it's business or it's IT. But they are in capacity to do some of the work and train some model, automate partially some of their tasks, with the assistance of a very old data scientist. Okay, so I will stop here. I hope you like it. If